Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. So today, I'm going to talk about story and the construction of a good story once again. And I'm going to do that starting off by talking about a bunch of personal things and my creation of a story, which hopefully you can get through that, and make it a counterpoint to what I really want to talk about, which is the Falcon and the Winter Soldier, as an example of the storytelling that you're going to get within the television and movies going forward for both Marvel and, I would say, DC as well. Because the thing is that a bunch of people are saying to me that, look, they're going to have to make money with these shows, and they're not going to go into the woke garbage that they've had in the comics, even though they're based upon these kinds of characters. And I would say, no, they're definitely headed straight into this woke nonsense that we've seen in the comic characters over the last 5 to 10 years. And the thing is that they're just simply better at it. People in the comic industry are very ham-fisted, especially right now. They just shove this in your face. But the people in Hollywood, well, they're snake oil salesmen. They're very good at selling these things that you don't want to hear. And that's what you're going to get with these new shows. But again, I'm getting ahead of myself. Before I get into that, I want to talk about the counterpoint to that, which is something personal, which is my own creation of a graphic novel. And by the way, you're looking at the art for my graphic novel in the background. So I ran into a comment over the last week where someone said that I used to be a teacher of how to understand and get rid of woke ideology. And now I've just become a snake oil salesman myself by shilling my graphic novel over and over again. And answering that actually will bring us right to the point that I really want to get to, which is good storytelling. The thing is that with my channel, I've never pretended to be a teacher. In my own life, I had a chance to become a teacher, a chance to become a professor. And I just said, no, I'm not doing that. I looked at the woke ideology that controlled the university system and went, no, I'm not doing that. So I'm not a teacher. I'm a storyteller. That's the only thing I've ever actually wanted to be. That's the only thing I've ever actually purported to be on this channel. I'm a storyteller. And the thing is that I've written a whole lot of stuff that is stuck under my bed, and then I finally decided to myself, okay, I'm going to write something substantial. So I wrote a novel, and then I got it edited and edited again and got it all ready to be published, and then I went into the publishing world to see if I could get it published, and I saw just how woke and how preposterous the publishing world actually is. And I said to myself, oh, I am not going in that direction either. But when it came along that I could actually publish a story, crowdfund a story, by myself, well, then I said to myself, I can be master of my own ship here. I don't have to go through this woke, ideologically controlled system of publishing in order to get my stories out there. And I said, great, I'm going to take that chance. And the second thing is that I not only want to be a storyteller, but I want to be a good storyteller. Because I could just, like a lot of people, take my stuff and just shove it out there on the internet and have people read it. But honestly, I don't think that would give me the correct feedback in order to become a good storyteller. I need to be tried by the fires of criticism. And I don't think there's any better way to do that than for me to sell my story to an audience. And when you fork over your money to buy my book, if you have done so, I'm sure you're not going to feel lax in any way about telling me if you don't think you got your money's worth. And that criticism is going to hone my storytelling into something better and better. That is the fires of criticism. I need to sharpen the sword of what I do and what I want to do by that criticism. And so, yes, I sell my book. At the first of every video, I talk about, if you wish to buy my book, this is what it's about, because I want to be a storyteller. But the thing is that I want to be a storyteller about heroes. And really, that's what my channel is about. My channel has never been about discussing woke ideology, about how to destroy it, and teaching other people how to get rid of it. No, it's been about heroism. That's from the very first. When I was setting up the channel and it said, describe what your channel is, I said it was about heroes. And that's what it continues to be. And that is, on my part, partly selfish, because I want to be heroic in my own life. And so I need to understand what heroism really is. I need to understand it better and better, and I need to recall it to my mind when I forget the things about it that I should be calling to my mind every day. And I've found that there's a couple of really good ways to get yourself into being heroic, into being that person you really want to be the hero of your own story, of your own life. Number one, it is to surround yourself by good people. And number two, it is to study and understand what that goodness actually looks like, what you want to be, and how you're going to get there. But that second part, I found in my study of such things, was very much clouded by the woke ideological ideas that have been implanted into my head over the last couple of decades, as I am part of this society. I have to get those things out, and I realized that very specifically at one point. I was missing things not because they weren't there, but because I had to get rid of this woke ideological talking points that were stuck in my head just by being part of the culture that is around me. And so, yes, when I talk in my videos about how to understand and how to recognize what is going on with quote-unquote progressive ideology, with woke ideology, how to get rid of it, how to get it out of your mind, how to identify it when you read things, it's because I want to be heroic. It's because I want heroism to be the part of my life that makes me who I wish to be. And the thing is that that's objective. It's not subjective. It's not what I understand heroism is. Heroism is. It is according to what is, according to reality, according to what is good. And the thing is that as an individual, I have blind spots. I quite clearly recognize that. And again, there's no better way for me to understand what my blind spots are than for other people to poke holes in what I say and what I think. And again, that brings me back to my storytelling and my story about a true hero. And I'm sure those of you who read my graphic novel are going to poke holes in it and say, this doesn't work. Why are you doing that? How come this doesn't connect to that? And it's going to put a spotlight on those holes within my storytelling, within my understanding. Again, it's something that's a little bit selfish on my part, I freely admit. But just like my videos, I am producing something for you so that you can poke holes in it and I can understand better what I do understand and what I don't understand about being heroic. And I believe that you, as an individual, can do that. You as the reader, you as my audience, you singular as my audience. Each individual, you can do that because you have a human nature. You understand what good is. You understand what heroism is. You understand what reality is actually asking of you through your human nature. Because I believe you have a human nature, an individual human nature, and you can do so. And so you can connect to these ideas that I am not trying to create, but trying to bring out of who you are and who I am as individuals. And so I can take your criticism, and it is something that I can build on. But here's the thing. All of what I have just described about what I am trying to do, why I'm creating a graphic novel, and shilling for my graphic novel, by the way, link is in the description for my graphic novel if you want to go over and see if my graphic novel is for you. But the thing is that all that I have just described is based upon a very individualistic idea of what I am, of what you are as a person in my audience, etc., etc. It's very individualistic. I, as an individual, am creating something for you as an individual so that you as an individual can then comment on what I don't understand or what I might understand or understand better. And it is, again, based upon that individualistic idea of human nature and the dignity and worth of that individual human nature that you possess and I possess that can become heroic. But that is the exact opposite of the way that the stories within the MCU, and I would say the DCEU, whether it be television or movies, are constructed right now. Now, I would say the original Marvel movies were constructed in a way that did have some individual traits to it, because they were based upon great stories created by individuals. And so they did have a strain of that within them. But we're now getting into a phase of the MCU wherein Kevin Feige has said, look, we're taking these characters that we know have never had any real great stories within their own medium, within comics, but we are going to now create great stories for these characters. But here's the thing. How does Hollywood create a story these days? Well, it creates it not through individuals, but through a consensus. A group of individuals, a panel, is going to put together your stories for you. And I would say this is one of the reasons why a lot of people look at these stories and go, it has no soul. Why does it have no soul? Because it's not created by an individual. A committee does not have a soul. A committee is not a human being. A committee is a soulless thing. That's why they create soulless stories. And as a committee that is creating these stories, they're also not creating them for the individual. When they talk about the audience, they're talking about the audience as you, plural, not as you, individual. And this is why you have current, and I would say decades-old Hollywood, that is slowly being more and more indoctrinated into the woke quote-unquote progressive socialist mentality. Why? Well, because that's exactly the basis of this socialist mentality. You, as an individual, don't matter. It's the society that matters. So, within this video, I'm doing things a little bit backwards as I usually do them. I'm giving you all of that thesis, to begin with, and now I'm going to move into the supporting evidence for that, with the words of the director of the Falcon and Winter Soldier, as she was giving an interview for one of the Marvel podcasts. And by the way, that podcast, the link for it is in the description. If you're not watching this when it specifically came out, that might be an old link, because Marvel tends to take these podcasts that are on its website and change the links to them over and over again. But if you go to the Marvel website and the podcast part of the Marvel website, you can also use the title of the podcast to find it as well if the link has changed. So here's the supporting evidence to what I have just said. It is the words, again, of the director of the Falcon and Winter Soldier. Now, to give you just a brief insight into the mentality of the woman who is the director for Falcon and Winter Soldier, two of her previous ventures within Hollywood just before Falcon and Winter Soldier are, number one, The Handmaid's Tale, which is constructed as a progressive nightmare boogeyman dystopia that they can point to say, look, this is what we're going towards if you don't do what the progressive ideology wants you to be. And the other one was a television series called The Loudest Voice, which talks about, in a dramatic fashion, the corruption in Fox News and its creation and its running, which I'm sure has no political agenda whatsoever. Now, right off the bat, this woman, when she's talking about creating this story, she's talking about not creating something for an audience, not creating something like the original stories that the Falcon and Winter Soldier and Captain America were based on that they're using, which comes from the 1980s stories in the comic books, where Captain America was just an adventure hero. That's really all that he was. It wasn't really political in any way, in so much as, yes, he's Captain America, so he wears a flag. So there's going to be something tied into that that has a political theme to it. But that's not the underlying message of the story. That's not what the stories were going for. That's not why the stories were created. He was simply an adventure hero. But for this director, Captain America and everything that goes around Captain America is something quite opposite. She was asked on this Marvel podcast about what she hopes to do with the Falcon and Winter Soldier. And she says the following. I've always been attracted to projects that have something to say and that are trying to move the needle and have a political perspective. And then she goes on to say that she's talking about the story of the shield. So it's not really a story of Captain America. It's the story of the shield. That's why the shield is so important, because it is the shield that makes Captain America, not the actions of Steve Rogers that make him Captain America. It's the shield. So she talks about what the story of the shield is, and then says this leads into the questions of what is a black Captain America? What does it look like? And then says, we started with that as the DNA of our narrative. Now, first of all, you see, she said quite specifically that she's attracted to this story because she wishes to move the needle on the political perspective. Therefore, from the get-go, we know that she's not telling a story for the audience. She's telling a story for a political reason. And that political reason centers around the shield, what it means, and what a black Captain America looks like. Not a Captain America that is someone other than Steve Rogers. But no, you see, these people who claim to be non-racist, or as they say, anti-racist, it's not about individuals as they are human beings. It's about the color of people's skin. And of course, as she says, this is the DNA of their narrative. And I always love when people like this use that word, narrative. Because of course, when you talk about the definition of narrative, it doesn't just mean a story. It means the part of the story which is not the dialogue. And I would say, if you're actually writing for an audience, yeah, the dialogue is what matters, not your narrative. The narrative is there to support your dialogue. But for these people, it's obvious that the dialogue is just there to support the narrative. And we'll get more into that in a minute. And then she says something which I've run across over and over again with Marvel Comics. She says, we're allowed to be funny, and we're allowed to be deeply dramatic, and we're also full of action. So we're really ticking all the boxes, and we're also allowed to say something. It's a dream for any director. Now, number one, this statement, we are allowed. I have heard Marvel writers say that as well. This is what we're allowed to do with our story. And again, this brings us back to the point of, This is not created by an individual. It is not created by or for an individual. It is created by a committee. A committee decides what you are allowed and what you're not allowed to do with your story. So again, this just points back to the fact that this is a soulless creation of some kind of committee or other that is allowing the director to do this or that. It's not like the great movie stories of old, where the director is the writer, or the director works very specifically with the writer and crafts something that is an individual tale. It's not that at all. It's something quite opposite of that. And then again, she goes back to the DNA of their narrative and says, "And we are allowed to say something." And then continues by saying, "This is the dream of any director." So what does she see the job of any director as being? Well, according to her mindset, the dream job of any director is to take all of these things that you use within the telling of your story and say something with it. As she said previously, to give it a political perspective. And again, this comes right back to the point that this is not an adventure story. It is a narrative. It is a narrative to sell you a political perspective. Why? Because it's not treating you, the individual, as the audience. It is treating the audience as a whole, as a social construct, and this plays right back into the socialist ideological mindset of, yes, we have to move the society. We don't care about the individuals, we care about the society. And so shape and mold them, every individual, as simply part of this society. And also, just to give you some idea of what this person, this director, actually knows about Marvel and about these stories, well, she goes into a quote where she says, "I was new to the universe. I'm a big fan. I wasn't new to the world. You can't possibly know the world unless you work in it." So her statement right here is that unless you work in the world of the MCU, you cannot understand these characters and you cannot understand this world. Now that, I would say, is one of the biggest slap in the faces to the fandom of these characters that you could possibly even imagine. You, as a fan, you really don't understand what's going on. You don't know anything about this world. As she says, you can't possibly know it unless you work in this world. And she's talking about working in this world as in the actors are part of this world in creating this world. You don't work in it as a fan, as an audience. Therefore, you don't understand it. And you see, again, this is a mindset of you don't really need to understand it anyways. Why? Because it's not about the story. It's about the narrative. Also, by the way, she says that she depends upon the actors to know their characters rather than to know them herself. So she's depending upon the people who play each of these characters to know their characters. She doesn't care about things like continuity or where these characters are coming from. No, she expects the actors to know that, and she's just there to direct them in order to bring about this narrative that she wishes to create. And then she goes more into what she thinks her job as a director itself actually is. And she's talking about the story of the Falcon and Winter Soldier. And she says, "We're so current, by accident, with all the things that have been happening within the summer of 2020. Those would be the race riots, by the way. But she goes on to say, "My job as a director is to open the doors to discussion, not in a way that resolves the issue, but in a way that provokes thought." So, first of all with that, again, you see that she's not there to tell a story. It's not her purpose as a director, she thinks, to tell a good story, or to present a good story, or to take what she has given and give it a faithful adaptation. No, she's there to provoke thought. She's there, once again, to sell the narrative. And you may think that that might be a noble thing when she says, but it is to open these doors to discussion, not in a way to resolve the issues, but in a way to provoke thought. That might seem noble to you. But I'll continue on with some of her statements and show you that that thought that she wishes to provoke is only in one direction. Again, it is the direction of the narrative that she is trying to create and sell. So a little farther on in the interview, she says that telling the story of Sharon Carter, telling her story from that feminist perspective was a real joy because we don't get to see that often in the space that we're in. I think we're going to see that more and more, but we've opened a nice little Pandora's box there, so all good. And no, that wasn't me adding something. That was her actual statement. We've opened a nice little Pandora's box there, so all good. So again, who or what is the character of Sharon Carter? She doesn't care. What she cares is that it's told through a feminist perspective. Now, I'm sorry, but if you want to talk about being female, if you want to talk about being feminine, you go right ahead. But as soon as you put that ist on the end of something, I'm sorry, that's your political narrative, sticking its head into what should be just a story that is created for me and my entertainment. And I don't need your ist in there if I'm going to actually enjoy the story. Which again, points right back to the fact that this is not a story created for you and for your entertainment. It is a story created to once again promote the narrative that she herself talks about. And then she goes on to discuss what her sets look like. She says, "The way I run a set, the way I run a show, is that all ideas are good and embraced, and I want to have a safe space where everybody feels like they're able to contribute." First of all, that's a bunch of nonsense, because why in the world would you have a director at all if everybody and their ideas are going to count? If everybody and their ideas are simply going to run the show, then why do you need a director? So I guess the reason why she's saying this is that it's a safe space, so everybody can bring up their ideas, but she's going to be the last word on whether these ideas are good or bad, whether these ideas are going to get into the show or not. But the thing is that, is it really a safe space in order to bring up all these ideas? Do these actors really have a safe space to talk about any kind of idea that they want to on the show? Well, from the very fact that she says she wants a safe space so everybody can feel comfortable and talking about feminism, I would say no. It's not actually a safe space. It's a safe space for people who have one kind of ideological talking point in their head and it controls what they say. But from the very fact that she uses the word safe space and a feminist story, you know automatically that this is not a safe space for anyone who counters those narratives and thinks that those things are not actually something that should be brought into a story. Oh, and she also goes on and says she wants a calm environment that pushes the envelope and is inclusive to everyone. Again, add that word inclusive to the pile of words like safe space and feminist and narrative. And add that on top of the stories that she likes to tell and the way that she wishes to have a political voice within her stories and the fact that she's directed things like The Handmaid's Tale and a story that shows how Fox News is evil, and I think you can understand what kind of safe space she actually is talking about. And further than that, what kind of discussion she actually wishes to promote. She said again that she wishes to provoke discussion, and that discussion doesn't actually give you the answer. They just want people to talk about these things. If you only have one kind of political narrative that is being presented to you within the narrative of the story, then what kind of discussion do you think that's actually going to produce? It's going to produce discussion only in one direction. And then we move on to the biggest quote that I want to give you from this interview. The interviewer says, "What do you want the fans to get out of this series?" And the director, she answers by saying the following: "I'd like us to have moved the needle. The racially charged conversations that we're having, the nationalistic conversation that we are having, you know, we are really pushing a lot of buttons. And we aren't solving them, we're posing the question. So the idea, I think, if we can come away from a thoughtful place with the fans and the audience feeling like there's more we need to do, there's more we need to think about. It's not so obvious, right? Then I think we've done our job. So looking at the red, white, and blue of it, it's really important that we don't take it at face value. That we dig underneath it to make sure that the iconic symbology of it is working for us in a way that it should." So I think that takes everything that I have discussed and wraps it up into one nice little package. So what is the heart of what she's trying to say? What is her job as a director? Her job as a director is not to present you a good story. Her job as a director is not to present a story to an individual. Her job as a director is to focus on the audience, that is, the audience as plural, not as individuals, but as a whole, and as a social whole, as a political whole. And her job, again, is to take the narrative and to use it to provoke discussion so that people begin to talk about these things and think about these things. But again, as I've said, this discussion and this thinking and talking about things is only in one direction. When she talks about racially charged conversations or conversations about nationalism, what kind of a discussion do you think is going to lead out of a narrative constructed by the person that I have just described for you in her own words? Now, before I move on from there and talk about what she says at the end, let's look at this idea of the discussion she's always going on about and about the narrative that she mentioned at the first. As I said at the first, if you have a narrative, that is to say, a narrative within a story, And a narrative within a story is the non-dialogue parts of the story. If you have that kind of narrative, isn't it supposed to be in service, or at the very least, in sync with the people and the dialogue within your story? Isn't the story about the people, not really about the narrative? And so your dialogue within your story is actually supposed to matter. And your narrative should serve the dialogue of the people within your story. But you see, these people, they're working on a story. It's just not the story you think they're working on. They want to provoke discussion. They want to create discussion in the real world. They want to create discussion out of your mouth as a part of the society. You see, they're providing a narrative with what they are producing, and that narrative drives along the discussion, not within the story that they're writing, but within the story of the nation. This is what they're trying to do. This is how they're trying to shape the nation itself. The story that they're writing is the story of the nation, or that they think they're writing anyways, and their narrative, again, is to promote and is to shape the discussion that you have. And again, certainly not as an individual, but as a member of the society. And of course, this all centers around, as she says, the red, white, and blue of it. It is the iconic symbology, as she says, which honestly, I don't think that's a real word. Maybe it has become so in the last number of years, but it never used to be. Anyways, it is the iconic symbology of the shield. Again, not of Captain America. Again, not of the individuals that actually hold the shield. And we definitely see that by the fact that she says a black Captain America. It's not the fact that he's Captain America or even really holds the shield. It's that because he has a certain skin color and then holds this iconic symbol. And it is this iconic symbol which, as she says, needs to be working for us in the way that it should. And once again, working for them in the way that it should is the political narrative that is going in one direction that they wish their audience to actually participate in. So all in all, again, it's not about a good story. It's not even about a story at all. It's about using the symbol of the shield of Captain America, combining it with someone who has black skin, and then taking that and using it in a political way to move an audience as a whole, as a society, in a political direction so that it moves the needle and moves society in that direction itself. So she's a director, all right, but she believes she's the director of your story. She believes she's the director of your life as part of the society, not just the director of this simple story that she has in front of her. In her mind, she's the director of the narrative that shapes the dialogue, that shapes the discussion coming out of your mouth. Once again, you plural, you as the part of the society. Because again, in her mind, she is helping direct the story of the nation. And by the way, I'm actually recording this video on the 3rd of July, 2021. Tomorrow is the 4th of July. Tomorrow, people will be celebrating the very thing which makes this shield something extraordinary. It is the flag that is on that shield. It is, as she says, the red, white, and blue of it. How many people who are going to be celebrating the 4th of July, who are listening to my voice, thinks that this is an appropriate use of the iconic symbol of the shield of Captain America? America was not built on a socialist mentality. America was not built so that each of the individuals could be forgotten in a political drive to move society in one direction and one direction only. America was created for the individual, so that each individual could pursue his own happiness, so that each individual could fulfill his own life in the manner that he deemed himself necessary. And as you see, this kind of directing, this kind of storytelling, if you can call it that at all, is not something that is going to promote the idea of the individual at all. It doesn't have the motivation, like I had discussed at the first, talking about my graphic novel and the creation of it. It does not take into account nor build upon the individual. Indeed, what it does is it tramples the individual. It tramples that heroic spirit that is built into the system that is supposed to allow people to be free enough to become heroes of their own story. It tramples all of that. It squashes the individual for the good of the society, and does so under the banner of the red, white, and blue. So, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like. Hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. And don't forget, the link is in the description for my graphic novel. a graphic novel that is created by me, an individual, for you, an individual, as the audience, and is built upon the idea of a true hero. So if any of that sounds appealing to you in any way, you might want to click on that link in the description and go on over and see if my graphic novel is for you. All right, I'll leave it there. I'll see you later. Bye.